Welcome to Draw One Last Breath Horror Podcast. My name's Matt.
I'm Butch.
I'm Jolly Paul.
Welcome to episode 135. We have been to the cinema to watch Talk to Me. We've got something to scream about in the middle section. We're going to be talking about the future of cinema, which will be an interesting conversation. And our movie from the vault is going to be Deliverance. And on this episode, we have a very special guest. He's a very good friend of ours, and he's been on the podcast before. It's Jon, Alleycat Jon, as we call him. How you doing, buddy?
Squeal like a pig!
Jesus. Such a tone.
I should have said, he sure has got a pretty mouth.
Cheers. Yeah, I'm all right. You all right?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm good. I'm glad to have you on again, mate.
Yes, yeah, nice.
Too
nice
long.
To be here. Yep.
Good. Excellent. Let's get into things. What have you guys been up to this week?
Well, I've been watching some fucking lot of alien stuff, like weird, like Fire in the Sky, which you recommend.
Finally watched it.
Yeah, a bit of TV movie-ish, but yeah, not bad. Pretty. I get what you're saying. Like there's like a weird moment in it, which was pretty freaky. So I went and watched another one called Night Skies as well, which is about, it's kind of a true-ish story around Las Vegas. And again, it is very TV movie-ish, but again, probably a little bit freakier than Fire in the Sky, I think. Maybe because the aliens sort of just like pop up from nowhere and stuff. But it did have, they were very similar in their approach and showing the sort of like almost skyline approach to sort of like, you know, what the fuck these aliens are doing and alien autopsy and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, pretty damn good. Student Body I watched as well, movie with Kevin Smith's daughter.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say Student Bodies.
No, Student Body. It was
Okay.
Not as good as probably Student Bodies. A lot of off camera kills and stuff like that, and it had like one blood splatter moment. What's her name? Hayley Quinn Smith, another movie for her to sort of like try her acting chops that out on. So yeah, a couple of treats there. And Oppenheimer, which is a horror, you know, very Christopher Nolan's doing quite well in the box office. For obvious reasons, sold out everywhere in that 70mm print. That Oppenheimer movie was something else. It was pretty. I don't know if anyone else has seen it in the last couple of weeks. No, John hasn't. I know I went with you, Matt. Paul, you've seen it. It was an experience, definitely.
The funniest thing I've seen online is like somebody put on a picture, a screenshot of like an IMAX theater, and like it was completely sold out. Apart from like the first two rows, and there's like one seat taken in the front row, and somebody's put like, who the hell has booked that seat? Because they're just on their own, just one person right at the front row. I'm like, that's gonna be shit. Yeah.
Especially on an IMAX, it's so big.
Yeah, you'd be licking Cillian Murphy's chin.
Was it good?
So good though.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Oppenheimer, mate. Honestly, it was fantastic. Really interesting. Like I took so much off away from it, like from a historical point of view, like all this what for me as well, learning some of the scientist names, like Heisenberg was like one, obviously you heard that watching Breaking Bad. I didn't even know the connection between that, and also like I didn't realize that Albert Einstein was still alive as well, all that sort of stuff, the relationship between him and Oppenheimer. It was just like, whoa. I thought for some reason that I Einstein obviously was
Yeah, you think of him being like years and years and years ago.
Yeah.
that was
bizarre.
Definitely learning experience.
By that time, though, he'd been put out the pasture a bit. Because I think a lot of his theories got like debunked during that sort of time. But obviously, still a great mind. But yeah, the film's phenomenal. Like so well acted. The cast is unbelievable. And just when you think you've had enough stars, one more just randomly appears. It's amazing. But yeah, it's so good. And
it's loud.
Clean up the Oscars.
Yeah, it's loud. Like the fucking I've never seen something so, I mean, to see it in IMAX, I must be a complete, my ears will be bleeding if I watched it in IMAX. I can't.
Well, it was mostly people talking in rooms and stuff, I don't know.
Yeah. It is. It's a very, very talky film, but it's so well acted and so well shot. It's really.
I know he likes his score, doesn't he, old Nolan? He likes to cram as much score as possible into his films. I can imagine.
Pretty much doesn't stop the whole way through.
Nah, you have to make sure your brain's engaged when you first go into it, because it does. If you, it leaves you behind a bit if you don't sort of, if you're not ready for it.
Right. Yeah, even if you like go to the toilet, you're going to miss stuff. Like you'll miss one line, and then the whole film won't make sense. You'd be like, what?
Like how I felt the whole time I was watching Tenet.
Like, you know, the imagination game with Bendick as Alan Turing. It's sort of like there are bits in it where I'm like, because this whole premise is like very JFK. There's a bit of a courtroom ish in it with the whole Robert Downey Jr. character who's bound to win some kind of Oscar. But it was very much like that sort of moment where I was just like, what the f-? I just learning like all this stuff, like the whole thing about them trying to kind of build a whole conspiracy around his sort of Russian so-called Russian connections and stuff like that. It was just learning experience more than anything about, you know.
It's good because you don't really get much history on the atom bomb stuff, you know what I mean? It's sort of glossed over. Like, even before the film was coming out, I was trying to educate myself on what went on and stuff. All you know is they dropped the bomb on Japan, and that was it, really. I was like, I want to know more than that. I want to know what was the thought process and everything behind it, you know? And that, like, looking online and stuff, it was pretty vague, you know?
Yeah. I imagine it, like, the fuck that was kept under wraps because of the fucking guilt. Like, what they, you know, these, so you know, scientists and sort of trying to move forward with science, but at the same time, the consequences are just absolutely huge. Yeah, it was crazy. But there you go, that's my couple of weeks.
Who wants to go next? Geordie Port over in France.
Yeah, this is an international episode of the podcast. I'm actually currently on holiday in France. But I couldn't miss up the chance to speak to John. So I thought I'd best dial in. But yeah, I've actually watched quite a bit, lads, to be honest. I started a random film of the week on the random horror channel, Hellraiser 3.
That's the one in the disco, right?
Yeah, and the random fucking statue.
I kind of like that one, to be fair.
I did.
Well, I'm expecting to take full brunt of your wrath on this, but I didn't. It was a bit too shit for me.
Not even the Cenobite of all the CDs.
I don't know.
You've got to admit, the bit when he walks into the church and says, "I am the way," is pretty cool, right?
Yeah. Look, it's as ever with these films, there are glorifying moments, but just as a whole sort of piece, it just screams of starting to bleed as much money out of a franchise as we possibly can.
Well, there's 10 of them, so.
Well, exactly. it was all right, but again, just.
Yeah, when you go and watch the sequels after that, it makes Hellraiser 3 look like Citizen Kane in Punk Commandments.
Yeah, especially when the next one's set in space.
Well, it, to be honest, lads, it didn't get better from there, because I then went and watched Venom, Let There Be Carnage.
What?
Which is one of the worst films I've ever seen in my life. So I actually contemplated turning it off about halfway through, but I thought I'd best stick with it. So, oh my God. It should be impossible to make a bad film with Venom and Carnage in it, but they did it. So, and I can't wait for Venom 3 to come out. Yay! Woo. But yeah, so now, fucking hell. Dog shit. Absolute dog shit. So apologies if we've got the director of that. Oh, it's Andy Serkis. Sorry, Andy. Shit. Then I watched one of my favourite horror films of the last, it's probably 20 years now. I always say 10, but then I'm getting old. So I watched Stakeland.
Oh, cool. The vampire movie. Who's the lead of that?
It's a guy called Nick D'Amici. Loads of little random sort of acting credits, but yeah. Really good. I love that film. If you haven't seen it, it's definitely worth a watch. Considering like it's an independent sort of horror film. It does some interesting stuff with like vampires and cultists and stuff. So, and it's got Kelly McGillis from Top Gun in it. yeah, who's yours aging doesn't always, you don't always end up like Tom Cruise when you age.
Wow.
So, yeah. But no, it's a brilliant film. So I watched that. I watched a film on Amazon Prime called When the Lights Go Out. It's based in Sheffield. And of course, it's based in Sheffield. Hey, love. All right. And it's basically around the 1974 blackouts. A family move into a house and some weird shit starts going on. But it's pretty low budget. It sort of tries to pull off a concept that it doesn't really get. There's a couple of little creepy moments in it, but overall, it was a bit meh. I think it was reaching too high, to be honest. And then I went to see Oppenheimer. I know this is definitely not a horror, but I went to see The Turtles and fucking loved it. So, and then
I don't know, mate. It's got some definitely loads of horror elements in there.
Yeah, well, yeah, mutants. But then I just wanted to mention, again, not strictly horror, but Jesus Christ, did it unsettle me, a documentary called The Deepest Breath.
Yes, I think we all watched that, didn't we? John, have you seen this?
I've not seen this, no.
Oh my God, John. So I'm not gonna, I won't go into it because I think to go,
yeah,
into
don't
it,
spoil it.
Big stuff, but it's basically about free diving. So dive into 100 meter depth on one breath of air and coming back up.
All right.
I won't say any more, but it's 100% worth a watch because in the first 5 minutes, if they don't grab all the air, there's something wrong with you.
Oh, really?
Okay. It's a documentary, but like true life.
It is very good. And the less you know about it, the less you know about going in it, it's better. It's one of the documentaries that comes around and it's amazing. So
okay, cool.
Yeah, that was me this week.
Cool. What about you, John? What have you been up to?
I've just been taking it easy the past week or so, kicking back because it was my birthday, wasn't it? A couple of weeks ago.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
21.
And I had a lot of cash in my pocket, and as I said earlier, I went and took advantage of the sales in HMV.
Oh,
yes. A nice big stack of like Arrow video releases and 88 films and stuff. So,
well, what was your star buy? What do you think? What was the one thing that you think, yes, this is the thing?
Oh, I don't know yet. To be fair, I mean, it's a bit of a mixed bag.
So what, you just randomly picked quite a lot of...
Yeah, a lot of the titles, I just looked at the cover and thought, oh, that looks cool.
Lots of them, that.
Brilliant. What was a recommendation? I don't know who it was. I think it was a couple of episodes ago. You said about two witches.
Yes.
Yeah, I still haven't watched that.
I really liked it.
I think you owe me $8.99 on that one, to be honest.
I didn't tell anybody to go and buy it.
No, I'll give it its due. I was really into the first half, I think. It was really cool. Like I was
quite
like,
low budget.
Yeah, it's low budget, but I thought that was working towards its benefit in the beginning because I was holding back on a lot of scares, and the witch, when she was just like peering through the window and stuff, was really like ominous, you know? It was really creepy. So I was like, oh, this is cool. And as it went on, it was like, oh, I didn't know where the story was going and stuff, so it kept me intrigued. But then, doesn't it, like, it's about halfway through the film and then it just comes to a grinding stop almost. And then it starts another story. I was like, oh, well, that's great then, isn't it? So, and then the other story, I just felt completely just shit the bed. I was like, I've got no interest in this. But how does it connect with the other one? And it kind of does. And there's more than two witches. There's a whole gang of witches. It should be called the Gang of Witches, shouldn't it? Really? I don't know.
I like that title, Gang of Witches.
And when it got to the end of the second story, I was like, all right, I'm really intrigued now because you're just throwing weird stuff out there without any like narrative. So maybe you're going to wrap it all up in the last 5 minutes or so. And it just comes up with a big screen at the end that says to be continued. So it's like,
I mean, I'm in.
I did like the scene where the guy was levitating and for no reason whatsoever, they just ripped his pants off.
Oh, yeah.
The witch like kind of used some sort of powers to just take his underwear off without me in there. It's quite amazing, really.
She was trying to basically just assault him, wasn't she? I think. Oh my god.
Cool, man. Yeah. And what was the other Arrow video release? There was one I watched this week called Girls Night Out.
Okay.
Yeah, it had like a bear on the front with like a Freddy Krueger.
Oh, like, oh yes, yes. I've heard that's shocking.
It wasn't the best. I mean, it was run-of-the-mill 80s slasher. I quite like the concept because the killer is like in a high school mascot bear costume. So that was
furry.
Yeah, and you had no idea who the killer was, and it did a good job of like having you guessing, kind of way Scream does. Like it was a precursor to Scream. But again, another. By the time we got to the end, it kind of fobbed you off, and it was like, oh, it's this girl that you saw for 3 minutes at the beginning. So yeah, and it's just like one of these films where a lot of the kills are off screen and stuff, so that was a disappointment. There was the Arrow video box set that I was very pleased with.
That looks amazing. Like
video store. As I said, it's got some classics in there. Cellar Dweller, Robot Jocks, Arena. I mean,
Arena.
There's like a boxing guy and he's on a space station and he has to punch aliens.
Fucking yes. What's that called? Arena?
Arena, yeah. It's the whole film set around, you know, the humans fighting aliens in a boxing ring.
100%. If you see the artwork of the video, you would have seen it in the video shop. It was one of those that was always on the shelf, wasn't it? Always.
Yeah.
And I picked it up. I don't think I've ever seen it. Still not, but I used to pick it up all the time. It was one of those.
Yeah, it's weird because like it's funny with it because the whole set is based on Empire Pictures, so there was like a company that produced a lot of films in the 80s with like straight to video, so a lot of like films you've probably seen, you didn't realize it was the same company, like From Beyond, Reanimator, Dolls, Cellar Dweller, Ghoulies. It was all part of this in-house like production team that would like make films on a low budget, but like you could just do anything you wanted. So if you had a crazy concept about boxing aliens, then you could just run with it, you know? And it was all like one of the things that, and it's all shot on like 35mm, so they all look great. And they're like that, like the main focus was like on having like the presentation of the films, you know, be as high as possible, and like the special makeup effects, like all the monsters and stuff, like the aliens in the arena was amazing. I was sitting watching it, I was like, they can't even replicate that today, like in most major films, you know?
True.
Indiana Jones. Oh, bullshit.
So, yeah, it's quite, it kind of like a kind of like a weird melancholy nostalgia feeling watching it, because I was like, oh, it's a shame, because you're never going to have that, or we might do now that most of these major films are bombing now. It's like, but it was nice to see like a period in time where it's just like, any ideas could go through. Like they were just happy to make anything on like next to no budget. You know what I mean? And care about the product. It wasn't just like, you know, sometimes with trauma just kick stuff out and you think, oh, there's not much craft in it. They're just trying to be as shocking or grotesque or whatever as possible. You know what I mean? Like
Totally. Like, it's like when they keep going on about making another Gremlins movie. The whole reason why they won't make another one is because the actual puppets cost so much to make. If they're going to do it, they have to use animatronic puppets, and that's going to cost so much money.
Yeah,
they've got the so fucking money. They're making bank. Let them fucking spend the money. Stop going in the fucking pockets.
Well, we'll get into that later. You hold fire.
All right, Matt.
Anything else for you, John?
Oh, and yeah, the last one I watched, I finally got around to watching The Batman, which I missed upon release. So,
what did you think?
What, Robin old Pattinson. Twilight Boy?
Yeah.
Twilight Boy.
Wow.
Yeah, I liked it. I thought I was going to love it, but I ended up just thinking it was very good. Like, it wasn't like a 5-star movie for me. It was kind of like a 4-star.
I agree. Yeah.
Yeah.
It sort of got you entertained, but it was like, you kind of wanted it to be like groundbreaking because of all, but yeah, it was a good movie. I haven't rewatched it yet.
I really liked how, like, for the majority of the movie, it's a kind of a small story where it's just like it almost felt like Seven, but with Batman, where it's just
that's exactly how
picking up the clues of what the Riddler's leaving and like, you know, and just using like investigating the crime scenes. And it was a very much small scale, and most focus was like on the environment, on the city, and it wasn't like crazy, like, I don't know, the city's about to implode or whatever.
Yeah.
Until we got to the end.
It always has to be.
And I was a bit like, oh, you went there. You had to have like the city being like set under, like floods happening and being blown up and stuff.
It's almost like they got to the end and they're like, hang on a minute, this is great, but we haven't had any kind of catastrophe. Just put it in at the end.
Yeah, I think that was my probably one of the suits decision, you know, like and this is what the people want, and the running time, it was just a bit too long, I think.
Yeah.
Cut down.
It's different enough, isn't it?
Too long.
Yeah.
And nice. They could have cut, even though I love the penguin in it, they could have cut all that storyline out.
True. Yeah. It could have just been focused on. There was a lot of characters, wasn't there, for that? I thought. Yeah. I mean, I enjoyed Catwoman, but I don't know if she was really necessary either, to be fair. I don't know.
I could do it with just him and Riddler. Defo. Matt, what you got?
I've basically watched a film on Netflix. No, sorry, not Netflix. Shudder, called Quicksand. About
You got through it?
Just about. A couple of a couple go into, like, they go to Colombia on something, and they go hiking, and then they get caught in some quicksand, and they have to use, it's a bit like, you know, one of those films that's all shot in one place, and they have to figure out how they're getting out, and it was okay, but I think they could have done better with it. It's just like, but yeah, it's like, yeah, I wouldn't waste your time, but if you've got a spare like 90 minutes, maybe go and bang it out, but other than that, nah. And I also watched Creepshow 2, just for shits and giggles, because it's a great movie.
We also got
the one with the raft in it, the blob or the raft. Is it the raft?
Yeah, that's it. The raft.
Yes, raft. Yeah.
And can I get a ride or whatever it is? Thanks for the ride, lady.
That's mental. I love that. It's great.
The one with the Indian, that statue that comes alive.
That's right. Correct. Correct.
We also got a screener, Matt, didn't we? We got the opportunity to go watch. Cobweb, which is out in America, but due out very, very soon in the UK. Anthony Starr, Lindsay Kaplan in it. The trailer's out there at the moment. It looks fantastic, and it was a good little movie. Not bad.
I'm sure we'll be reviewing it for the pod eventually.
Yeah, defo. Should we get on to some real news then?
Go for it.
John, what you got?
Oh, just that the Exorcist trailer dropped. I think, was it last week?
Yeah.
Exorcist
the Believer.
Yeah. Now I was kind of on the fence before the trailer came out. I was kind of intrigued. I mean, say what you will about the Halloween films, I thought like David Gordon Green did all right. Like, I was quite intrigued to see what he was going to do with The Exorcist, you know? I mean, I was probably one of the only people that actually quite enjoyed Halloween Ends, and I was just like, yeah, I'll be interested to see what he brings to the table, because, like, at least with that one, he tried to do something different within the Halloween canon. So I thought, oh, it's not going to just be like a fucking, you know, cookie cutter copy of what The Exorcist was.
True.
But then as time went on, I heard some negative reviews from like pre-screenings and stuff. So I was like, oh, that doesn't sound good. But it's just people, you know, just hating on it because there was a lot of hate with Halloween Ends and stuff. But when the trailer dropped last week, my jaw was just on the floor at how terrible it actually looked. I mean, just in terms of visual aspect, to me, it looked like it was filmed for the Sci-Fi Channel. It was just like everything about it was just so bland. I just...
Controversial.
Yeah. I didn't have any of the vibes. Like, you know, when like those Halloween trailers dropped, they just literally like... really got the essence of Halloween. You saw those trailers and you was just like, yeah, they've nailed it. Expect, like, the look was perfect. But with this, it didn't. I was expecting, like, you know, it to be like kind of dark and somber and misty streets, you know, like that classic, like when he steps out in front of the house and that. But this is like opens up and it's set in like some high school, like it's like a Netflix drama, like Riverdale or something, you know? And it's just like, I don't know. The girls in it didn't scare me. The bit when she walked into the church and she's covered in blood, to me it looked like it was like the cheap blood you buy at like the joke shop when it's Halloween. You know what I mean? It's just like I don't know. It just I was not impressed.
If you compare it to like the likes of the, I mean, I don't know if this is a popular opinion, the Nun 2 trailer and stuff like that. Like, there's literally bits in that where I'm jumping out of my seat, like in the trailer. So I mean, I don't know if the movie's gonna, you know, do the same. But at least the trailer sort of.
I saw the Nun trailer too, because that played directly after The Exorcist when we went to see, what do you call it? talk to me. And I said, I turned to Ziv and I said, that looks infinitely more scary than The Exorcist.
Yes, it does.
The problem with the number two trailers, you've probably seen all the scary bits in the trailer.
Well, we'll see. But, you know, I mean, you know, but yeah, I agree. It's an interesting one. Considering there's like been quite a few trailers dropped. I mean, Saw X as well has also dropped. That looks like it's
a mammoth trailer.
It's a big trailer.
A lot of reveals.
Lots of traps. Yeah, lots of stuff going on that I didn't really want to fucking see. And it looks like maybe they're trying to go back to the first movie. But we'll see. I don't know. Spiral.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it's a prequel, isn't it? Isn't it? I don't know. Well, I can't pay attention enough to like when all the fucking things are going in. They're all like going on at the same time. They obviously lost it a bit with Spiral, and they want to go back to him. I don't know.
Yeah, but what they do though, and they've already done it because they've said it in the trailer, is they've made him the hero.
Yeah.
Why?
I know
he's murdering people in grotesque ways, but like, it's like justifying it, and I hate it when they do that shit because you just like it doesn't become scary then. It doesn't become a horror. It's like, well, they deserved it. They were all dickheads anyway, so you don't really feel sorry for them.
Yeah, I need them not to be asked. We'll see with the character development.
I'd almost like one of the Saw films to go, right, I'm going to take a group of people. You're going to think they're all bastards, but actually, it turns out that Jigsaw then kills them because they're all bastards, but it turns out that Jigsaw's been framed. They're not actually all bastards. They're all like fucking saints. But some sadistic serial killers like set them all up to do one on Jigsaw as well. See, that would be quite a good, cool ending. Twist on the franchise. But I can't share my idea with the world because obviously the guild won't let me.
Fair enough.
Is anybody else impressed with the Exorcist trailer? Because I just ragged on it. Like,
I actually quite liked it, to be honest, John. So.
Okay.
I don't know.
I could be wrong. I was pleasantly surprised with Evil Dead Rise. I didn't like the trailers to that at all. And when I saw it at the cinema, I loved it. So, you know.
Yes, yeah, you're right. Maybe they've done it. I mean, maybe they've held something back. And because a lot of the trailers. Yeah, I'm not really sure.
By including original cast members and by sort of really setting it in the actual sort of like canon of the original film, they've set a bar for themselves, which is probably astronomically too high. But I think they're going to have to hit a lot of right notes when you're going to include all like the original stuff. It's going to have to be pretty much perfect to impress anyone.
I don't know. Me and Matt were talking the other day and like with watching Talk to Me and stuff like that. And we're obviously going to go that in a minute. And kind of how that's setting apart a kind of new generation of horror in a very clever way. Exorcist needs to do that. It needs to appeal to a newer crowd of horror. And I don't know.
But they're also, they've got to also appeal to the masses. That's the problem.
Yeah, they've got to make money. Well, horror's making loads of money at the moment. It's like, how the fuck are they going to make money?
But they're already like 400 million in the hole. Because, like, that's how much Jason Blum had to pay Warner Brothers to get the rights to The Exorcist. So maybe that's why the film ended up looking a bit cheap in my eyes. Maybe they had to save on the production costs.
Let's just hope it's very DIY and it's
wow. Anything I would say, yeah, you bring back legacy characters, but I don't want it to be like how the Texas Chainsaw Massacre was with Netflix, you know what I mean? With Halloween, you could tell Jamie Lee Curtis wanted to be in it. She wanted to be a part of it. And it all felt like very, like, they were fans of Halloween and it felt very family like orientated, you know, just bringing everyone back because they really loved the franchise. With this, it also got like an eerie feeling when David Gordon Green said he didn't want to do it, but he just couldn't turn down the paycheck. So,
well, the thing is, it's a trilogy, isn't it, as well?
So. Well, now cut it back now to just two movies, apparently.
Oh, is it just two now?
Yeah.
Warning signs, alarm bells.
The Exorcist Believer and the other one's called Exorcist Deceiver, I believe. I'm not sure.
And the next one is going to be like, what's that song? I'm a believer. I'm a dreamer. I'm a. It's just going to be like anything that rhymes.
Your mother sucks cocks in hell.
Well, there's some other news out there as well. Like, I don't know if you know that. The Christopher Landon, who did Happy Death Day, has been on to direct the next Scream movie.
That's right. So Radio Silence are not doing it.
Well, there's a plethora of cinema movies coming out over the next couple of weeks. We've got Meg 2, come on, The Blackening, Cobwebs coming out, Exorcist's coming out, fucking Saw X is coming out. There's a lot of horror coming to the cinema, and there's a lot of horror that's making a lot of money this year, so even more than last year. So, I mean, Smile so far, like somehow that one absolutely smashed it. So
I enjoyed Smile. Sorry, I quite enjoyed
it's called good marketing. That's very what it's
good.
Called.
Very good. We'll see what's next. All right, shall we get on to our main review?
Let's do it.
You busy tonight?
You want a turn, eh?
My mum leaves at 9.
So you're at 10.
So where'd you get it from anyway?
Apparently it was the hand of someone who could connect with the dead.
I heard it was the hand of a Satanist. And the other hand's just out there.
White people shit, man, I tell you.
All right, let's do this! You know the drill. So, talk to me.
Talk to me.
Haley, fucking stop it, he's choking!
83 seconds, get it off him!
What if we opened the door, but we didn't shut it?
Delete it. Delete it, come on!
The spirits, they followed us.
We have to do something.
You want to do it again?
They're not going to stop.
What was it?
What?
I don't know!
I let you in. I let you in. Oh my God.
So, this episode's main review, we went to the cinema and we watched Talk to Me. When a group of friends discover how to conjure spirits using an embalmed hand, they become hooked on a new thrill until one of them goes too far and unleashes a terrifying supernatural force. Right. Without going into it too much and spoiling shit, I just want your first reactions, please.
Talk
John, you're the guest. Go for it.
Yeah, it's quite funny because I had no idea what this movie was. So I went in completely blind. From the title, Talk to Me, I thought it was going to be a biopic of Terry Tibbs from The Phone Checker. But
Talk to Me.
Talk to Me.
Talk to Me.
You want to buy a Ford Escort? But yeah, I was quite pleasantly surprised by this one. It kind of gripped me like I wasn't expecting, to be fair. It was creepy. Yeah, I was quite surprised at how well they did the scares. It was quite an interesting concept. I didn't have any clue where it was going to go. I thought the scenes when they contact the dead and stuff were really well done. The hell scene that was in it was probably one of the best visions of hell I've seen. And it's been a long time since I've been to the cinema and I've actually, you know, felt the chills a little bit. So it was effective. Yeah, I have to tip my hat. It was a good movie, I thought.
But yeah, I'm not your standard jump scare horror. This was a sort of plethora of visuals, exposed your senses in terms of watching the horror movie. Very of the now in terms of what it's doing. It definitely appealing to a younger sort of generation of horror movie goers, which was quite interesting. But it felt fresh, new, and I felt there's a real interesting item that they've introduced into the horror pantheon. I think with that hand, I think it's great. Yeah, I very much enjoyed this movie.
Really cool.
Well, a big tick from me, guys. I thought it was great. Really did. The first 5 minutes, what a way to start a film.
Yeah.
Because obviously I'd seen the trailer. I knew that was sort of C&C Ouija stuff. But actually, the first 5 minutes of the film take you down a completely different path. And I didn't expect it. It was quite visceral, quite violent. Yeah. And from there, I just thought it was really good. Thought the way that, like Paul says, the hand, I thought was a great bit of, you talk about marketing and prop placement, I just thought it was brilliant. How many of them are going to be shipped out? People are going to start buying them. People might start making pin badges of them. Who knows?
Oh, yeah.
I thought it was great. I thought the actors were great. I just thought the whole central concept was really, really good, and it was really well done. Yeah.
Matt?
It was very deep, wasn't it? It was very... Okay, towards the young people, I thought it was very much.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like, all young people are fucking idiots. Yeah.
That's you just getting old, bitch. Yeah. Hey, Matt, what you got?
I hated it every second of it. No, I'm joking. I'm kidding. Possibly, this is hands down my favorite movie this year so far. Fucking
no pun intended, Matt, hands down.
Yeah,
that went over his head. He didn't know that he was.
I'm too busy loving this film, mate. I literally have not got a bad word to say about this film. Like the trailer, when I saw the trailer, I was just like, ugh. I was like, here we go again. I was like, not interested. I don't think the trailer gives it any body to the film. It's just like, oh, another one. But I just think, like, literally. I just liked everything in this movie. It's fresh, it's new, it's different. The sound design was absolutely fucking off the chain. It actually scared me. I was like, I just felt, I don't know, it's like one of these movies comes along in a blue moon, like, you know, Following or, you know, just like Midsummer or something like that. And this to me felt like that. Every literally scene in this movie I loved.
Well, it goes along with that line. So we watched like Hosts a couple of years ago, and you've got a couple of brothers from Australia, the Phillippou brothers, who have been an absolute sensation on YouTube.
Raka Raka.
They're creating like these amazing sort of like almost stunt videos and stuff.
Have you watched any of them?
A couple of the Jedi ones and stuff like that since I watched the movie. They're great. They're good watch. And it's like, you know, fucking people enjoy themselves filming shit and making stuff.
I mean, Brilliant. They've been around for a decade.
You know, I'm not the most person who's watching YouTube every fucking 5 minutes. But like these boys have come up with this concept like is absolutely fantastic. The characters that they sort of come up with, I've got depth and like they're really interesting. So even like the slow bits and stuff like that, you're still kind of like, I kind of don't want to know or care about what's going on. But some of the real action and stunts in this movie and the special effects, I was like, fuck, fair play. I mean, you know, it's sort of obviously we've got the hand. Obviously, we've got these moments of like speaking to the dead. And those moments is kind of stunned and shocking. They're not like jump scares, but they do kind of go, "Ooh, fucking hell, what did I just see?" And the moments of violence, especially with the young brother and stuff like that, like that was fucking shocking. And I was like, "Well, fucking done, well done on just being able to deliver that sort of vase of violence in sort of and making it so like prevalent to the movie and not just and, like necessary." I don't know. I really did get on with this for most of it.
I was impressed with how they did the scares, like when the ghosts and that would show up. It wasn't like most modern films that are catered towards a younger audience, you know, like where they rely so much on like the sound system and like, you know, the big noise and jump scares and stuff. This is very much when the ghosts show up, it's mostly silent because they're just in shock, you know, and it was and everything was well lit and stuff, but the makeup and everything, and it was just so well done. It's like the filmmaking and the editing and just, I was really surprised at how effective it was with so little. They didn't have to try so hard to try and push the scares. You know what I mean?
The pacing of it was really well done, wasn't it? As well, there wasn't any kind of boring bits. There wasn't no bits that I was thoroughly like, kind of, just in it. And just, I loved the way obviously when there's so many possession films out there, like, I was thinking, you know, how are they going to do it? And they literally done it in a different way. Like, the way the eyes went black and they kind of take their head back. And I loved the whole lore around, you know, it's got to be 90 seconds. You hold the hand for 90 seconds. You let them in. And it's just like, obviously, we're all like, for fuck's sake, that was way more than 90 seconds. We all knew that that was going to fuck everything up.
It did kind of remind me of Flatliners a little bit, though. That's the one thing I'd say.
Completely, completely. That testing.
They keep pushing each other. They want to do it for longer. You know what I mean? And then the ghosts are not really quite gone. They're still hanging around and stuff.
100%.
Yeah. But I liked how this sort of kind of brought the new sort of, like, you know, like a film like kids doing stupid shit at parties. You can imagine people are going to start doing this kind of shit at a party. You know, like Candyman or Bloody Mary or that type of stuff. They've actually sort of made that overnight. Of this new sort of thing that you'd be a bit sort of, oh, we'll try it, but will I try it? Will I really do it? And I thought it was really good. Like, you can see, like, it's got a bit of a legacy to it where, like, the more and more people that'll see it, it'll ingrain itself into a bit of, like, popular culture, whereby you're like, you know, oh, let's do the hand thing. Like a Ouija board, essentially. So, yeah, no, I thought it was very clever.
Yeah, it was reminding me, like, it did a good job of reminding me of the days when peer pressure was a thing, you know, and you wanted to impress your mates and show how hard you was, and, you know what I mean?
It's funny you talk about peer pressure, because it reminded me of a moment I had over the weekend about making a certain person do a forfeit for a hen party that we're out with, but we won't name names, but there was a lot of pressure there saying, even when they were saying, do it. Do it. But I want to talk about the cast really for a little bit, because the main actor, Sophie Wilde. Now, I heard that basically a big studio took this film on originally before A24 picked it up. And there was a lot of involvement about saying that they wanted to do different things and introduce other things, and they wanted to introduce more lore about behind why the hand's there and how you defeat the hand and all that stuff. But the weirdest thing is they wanted a really big actor to be in that part to get bums on seats, and they stood their ground and they said no, we want Sophie Wilde. They took $1 million hit so they wouldn't have to cast a big name. And then they literally went rogue, and basically that's when A24 picked up, because they were saying that the Phillippou brothers were saying that everything was being taken away from them, the identity of the film. So they just said, no, we're not having no more of it. And then that's when A24 picked it up. And I've, like, hats off to them. Thank fuck they did.
Well, who didn't pick this movie up? I mean, fucking,
yeah, there was a ton of logos at the beginning. Jesus Christ.
Well, that's it, isn't it? Like, I was like,
film companies put
I thought it was like a fucking joke. I was like, Christ, it was like 10 minutes into the movie, and I was like, has it started yet?
That was very interesting. But again, I suppose
it was two for the Adelaide Film Festival. I was like, Jesus, come on.
I don't know, but it moved well, and I was looking through the cast list. There's not many from EastEnders Neighbours. Neighbours is gone now, isn't it? Home and Away, I don't know. There was one from Wentworth Prison that I could find.
she was really good.
So Miranda Otto, who is Eowyn in Lord of the Rings, that's pretty big. So
she was funny, man.
I thought she was fantastic, to be fair. Because you do watch films like this from time to time, and, like, the parents sort of can be the underused character, or the, you know what I mean, like, written poorly, but she was like a force of nature. Whenever she hit the screen, I was like, Jesus, you're either a really evil bitch or the best mom in the world. I can't really make up my mind, but yeah,
that's the thing. The comedy element was just right. It's just the right amount.
Yeah, totally. There was that little nod of it, but when the violence sort of poked in, I mean,
can we talk about the violence?
Let's do it. Let's talk about that photo. Was it
spoilers?
Riley. When they sort of, you know, he's a 15-year-old boy, he's sort of in the room, but he's not really part of it. There's a big montage of them all grabbing the hand, and you know, you grab the hand, you say, you put a candle on, you say, talk to me, and then they see this thing in front of you.
Terry Tibbs then is your body.
Yeah. and obviously a lot of them are seeing different dead things, different dead people. And then they say, I'll let you in, and it comes in. Whatever he let in was messed up, because there was one bit before where the kid was like masturbating on the floor and snogging the dog and all that sort of stuff. It was fucking gross.
The montage was fucking brilliant, though.
It was.
I thought that was so well done. The montage where they're just shot after shot after shot. It's just like, fuck, that must have took so long.
Yeah, it was immense. But then Riley took the helm, and the entity that sort of took him and just started smashing his head on the table, threw him across the room. It was brutal.
Mental, wasn't it? It was really mental.
There's certain things when that happens. Now, me and Butch watched a movie that still isn't out called Hosts with an S. And there's a scene in that, a dinner scene. And when it happened, I looked at me and Butch just literally looked at each other from the screen, at each other, and like was shocked, mouths open. I did exactly the same thing with Cy the Serb in the cinema. I looked at him, he looked at me, and it was just like, I was like, I actually said, fuck. I was like, what? And the whole cinema gasped.
And they never showed you his face into a lot later as well. You never really got to see the sort of result. You just sort of had to kind of play it in your mind. That was a lot of what he went through.
I was really wincing at the point when you thought he was going to rip his own eyeball out of his head.
But then the chair flies over and then he starts hitting his head on the fucking sideboard as well.
I just didn't expect that they were going to go that far. And like you said, John, that eyeball thing, I was like, are they actually going to do it? I didn't know. I had my hands up. I was like,
on that point, it's a fucking 15. I'm like, how did they get away with it being a 15?
The only thing I will say about it is that from that moment, which was about, I think, 45 minutes into the movie, I think with that moment, it didn't really grow from there in terms of the violence and I just felt the movie sort of just stayed
in the shower scene.
I remember the shower scene, but it wasn't as violent.
I agree. It sort of plateaued at that point. I thought it was going to up the ante and kind of stagnated.
But like John alluded to earlier, there were some other fucking scenes in it where you're just like, am I watching Hellraiser?
Mm. I don't know about you, but like you're saying, like, wow. That are you saying until it got to the house scene, or are you saying it didn't after
that? No, like after that thing with Riley, there wasn't. It didn't up the ante in terms of
you did see a baby getting munched, right? Did you not catch that?
Sorry,
I think I missed that as well.
In the house scene, there's a little.
Yeah, looks like I saw that. Baby munched in the head.
Oh wow.
You must.
No, I mean,
it was very quick cutting at that hell scene, though, wasn't it?
It was very Event Horizon in terms of its cut. It's like I could do what happened in that scene. I want to, you know, what is going on?
I don't know. I tend to disagree with that because I know you're like saying it kind of maybe it plateaued. I don't think it needed to be. Why did it need to up the ante even more after that?
I didn't say it needed to. I'm just saying it didn't.
Yeah. Fair point.
Yeah, there was some standout scenes. I mean, the fight with her father was also very good. I thought that was quite visceral. It was quite intense. All the scenes when the spook show. Yeah, it was very intense. The whole, supernatural aspects of when they kept showing up. But I would say, I don't know if it plateaued, but for whatever reason, when it got to the very final act, I did zone out a little bit. I don't know why, for what reason. It's just like when that whole bit when she goes to the hospital and then she's got the kid in the wheelchair and she's pushing him down the slope. I just kind of was like, oh, it's the film's losing me a little bit here. I don't know what the reasons were. I've been thinking about it all week and I can't. And I took turns to Ziv and she said, yeah, I kind of like, it's losing me a little bit at this point as well. And by the time you get to the actual finale, it should be a really shocking moment, don't you think? When you realise that now she's gone to the other side. And it was kind of like play for laughs a little bit at the end. I didn't have the emotional impact I was expecting No.
It did. No, agree. It didn't. It didn't for me. I liked that moment. I must admit, I did like that moment, but it didn't. It didn't have that emotional moment, and that's down to the fact maybe I was just like completely at a peak at that moment, and it just didn't drive on from there. Even though her story, like afterwards, was fascinating, like trying to work out like, is she possessed or is she not? Why has she got some dude's foot in her mouth? It, you know, is it the spirits and all that sort of stuff? There were some great moments.
I like that, the like astral projections kind of shit, man. I thought that was cool.
Yeah.
I like that.
But Insidious, like the first Insidious movie, it fucking went and went and went, and then you went into the fervor afterwards, and you're like, I'm sort of drifting through the fervor. That's the end thing. I mean, not in a bad way, but because I did this was very good.
Yeah, it was only a very slight nitpick that I had, really. Like, I just wish their ending was a little bit more handled a little bit differently. I don't know.
Like, did anybody, like, think, like, I was getting a feeling that the dad was going to be, like, dead as well, or he was a ghost? Because every time he turned up, there was no one else around.
That one bit that went through my mind,
and then like, you know, when the guy comes, her ex-boyfriend comes and stays with her old foot and mouth, also when they're screaming, he's screaming and they're shouting and stuff, the dad don't turn up, and I was thinking, fuck man, are we gonna have like a situation where dad's fucking dead? Because it's like you see him in the background at the kind of the funeral or the reunion, whatever it is.
It did a lot of things with the cinematography, which is really unusual. Like,
yeah.
There was never two people, hardly ever, in the same shot.
Yeah.
Always when they was talking to someone else was a bit out of focus and vice versa. Yeah. And I think it was trying to emphasize the feeling of loneliness and isolation, you know? And that's why she wanted to talk to her mother so much, because she just felt shut off.
Alone, right.
She felt alone, and I think it was also, I don't know what, it was kind of making a statement about how there's always people around, but no one really talks to each other, you know? Like, there's many instances where she was not communicating with her dad. She'd go and see a friend, and her friend's, like, constantly looking at the phone, like, scrolling through Facebook and whatnot, and it was like no one was really
paying attention.
Yeah, and paying attention to each other. But they all wanted to contact the dead, which is really weird. So, yeah, it was kind of, I think it was trying to play like that feeling you have, probably when you're grieving, when you're going through, when you lost someone and you feel like you're kind of shut off from the world a little bit, and no one really knows what you're going through. And also being a teenager, and when you've got a lot of angst and stuff, it does kind of sometimes feel like you're alone, you're on your own. So I think that was a stylistic choice with the cinematography to kind of
That's clever.
I was kind Very of clever. my major critique with it, guys, and I don't know if this sort of ties into what you guys are saying, is the ending. I just thought they could have went a bit ballsy with the ending. So the dad didn't have to survive.
You know, they did that. I think that was an afterthought, because didn't it feel like he was dead for reals, right? Yeah. And then they walk in and it's just that hole in his neck. I reckon that was an afterthought. They thought, you know, we're probably going to lose sympathy for the character if she outright kills her dad. I think that was probably, you know, something they did.
And also that gives her a bit of
hell, like, or something.
That also gives her a bit of like no reason to be there anymore either. So sort of, the dad's not there, mum's not there, she's fucking... She just killed him. Like, the comeuppances after that would be like, you know, well, she'd be fucking arrested or put in a mental home. You know what I mean?
I think they could have went, like you said, a bit more. They raised it to a height, and I think they stopped before they really sort of like pushed it on. Like, maybe they could have had where her dad dies, and then at the end she's all reunited with him in the afterlife, and she thinks, oh my god, yay, but then he goes to fucking, he's been tortured in hell because she finds out when she's dead that he killed her mother, really, or something. Do you know what I mean? Something like that could have really like pushed the film on. But I just thought, and like the tweeness of it, the guy's okay now. Even the guy at the start coming back, you know, the guy's brother, who you think, well, he's definitely gone. And they find him they accost him on a bus halfway through the film, and he gives a bit of exposition about the whole thing. And he sort of tells them the answer, whereas, you know, wait and it'll all be fine. But no one listens to him. But it's almost like throwaway comment. I just thought that was a bit like, well, he should really be dead.
So I got a question that I suppose bugging me. still is so were they fucking with her? Was he in hell, or was she the one that was like the demon, the sort of entities were with her rather than him?
To me, the way I saw it is they were trying to trick her into basically making sure he was dead so they could keep him.
Yeah, that's what I thought. They're manipulating people.
Yeah, so okay. With the whole kind of mother thing, like the mother, it wasn't really the ghost of her mother. It was a demon telling her she must kill, you know, it was a demon telling her that her dad's a wrong one, that he's not telling you something. It's not all true. That's how I got it anyway.
Yeah, like at the start when he stabs his own brother and stuff, it was probably demons telling him his brother's, you know, no good and stuff. Yeah.
And then so Riley's experiencing the shunting in hell, basically.
Yeah. Why get two souls? Why get one soul when you can have two?
Cool. All right. That's good. It was a good, refreshing movie. I really enjoyed talking about this one, to be honest. It was talk to me. Yeah, really good one. But I think we should rate it.
Go on, John. You're the guest. You go first.
As I say, it's up there. It's not quite a perfect movie for me. It's just shy of being bloody brilliant. I think it's a solid 9 out of 10, to be fair. Just as I say, for reasons I can't think of at the end, I just was a little bit phased out by it. I don't know. I was kind of lost me a little bit. But other than that, it was great. As I say, it was really good filmmaking. I was really impressed.
Paul? Butch?
Oh yeah, for me it's a 9, 100%. Like, it's so close to being a perfect movie. Even though I didn't say that it plateaued, there was just, it just followed a good exposition. It's a really good story to tell. Really interesting new introduction to the horror in general. I think that fucking hand's like so unique and brilliant. And
I want one.
Smells franchise to me, but we'll see.
Yeah, I kind of like the way they didn't give the hand much backstory. It was kind of cool that just to be like, oh, yeah, I got it from this guy and he got it from someone and it probably used to belong to a spiritualist. We don't really know. It's kind of nice to have something that was a bit ambiguous for a change, you know.
Completely. Geordie Paul?
I'm going to go slightly lower just for the ending. And I definitely think they should have killed that horrible bitch who fucking owned the hand and was an arsehole. Healy. Is it Healy? Oh, Jesus Christ, she definitely needed it. Anyway, so for that, I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10, guys. I was thoroughly impressed by it. It was very, very good. So, yeah, 8 out of 10.
Can I just say one more thing as well? Another slight nitpick. Who the hell still has the crazy frog ringtone on their phone?
Just Jay from The Inbetweeners.
Apparently, that is based on one of their friends' characters, one of the guy's friends in real life. They went to a funeral and they were at a funeral and his phone went off. It must have been when that old craze was on. That, I mean, when was that? Fucking early 2000s.
3 years ago, right?
Yeah, true. So,
I thought that was a very strange decision to put that in there, but now you've given it some context.
I think that was more of a personal choice, which is a weird one, because I was also like, what? That's like so old, unless it's meant to be like the 2000s, maybe, set in 2000, I don't know. Anyway, I give it a 9 out of 10 as well. For the first, you know, introduction, like most of these, the cast, it was their first movie. This is their first debut film. They stuck to their guns. They stuck to all practical effects. The soundtrack was brilliant. It kept me captivated the whole way through. Hats off to a man. I mean, if you're getting calls from Ari Aster and Jordan Peele, and Jordan Peele's FaceTiming you, man, you've done something right in my eyes. I fucking loved it. Maybe now talking on it, maybe the ending was a little bit, and yeah, I hope they don't franchise it out. I really hope they don't fuck it up, especially on that end kind of sting. But apparently, them guys have gone on and now they're doing pre-production, so it doesn't mean they're 100% doing it, but they're doing pre-production on Street Fighter.
Wow. That's changing tax.
Awesome departure.
if you look at some of their earlier stuff on YouTube, they do a lot of like fatality kills and lots of Street Fighter stuff, and they've got some interesting apparently ideas on how to do the kills. And apparently they've traveled to fucking like Thailand or something to meet the real Sagat that the game is based on and shit.
Wow.
It's like Yeah, their research is insane, but that will be interesting.
If you get to the keys to them kingdoms, you fucking exploit it, don't you?
Yeah, fuck it.
They have got another horror.
Jean-Claude Van Damme now.
Yeah.
I mean, it could be cool. I mean, because what I liked about this movie is it didn't feel like a studio film, you know? It felt very much indie-based and quite grounded. So if they do something like that for Street Fighter, it could be quite interesting, you know? Like,
like bring it down a bit and just make it a bit more raw.
Push that horrible 90s movie out of everyone's mouth.
Awesome. Cool. Well, on to next episode's main review, we'll be doing Meg 2 The Trench. So enjoy that one. Go see that bad boy. Right, let's move on to our Something to Scream About. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Okay, so this is Something to Scream About. I've brought a little question to the table. I want to talk about the future of the cinema and films in general at the cinema. Because I just want to bring it up because I think with all the strikes going on, and in Swindon, we've had a cinema actually close. And on the flip side, there's been all the press and the massive kind of thing around Barbie and Oppenheimer saving cinema. I don't know. I just want to kind of have a little chat about why you think it's, you know, what's happening. Why is it not so great? And what's the future?
Okay. Let's kick this off then. It's not the cinema at the moment, like compared to if you compare it to the last couple of years, the money's not there as much. Has it bounced back from COVID, like pre-COVID? Don't know. But like, what's really kind of interesting is this whole AI obviously thing, which is, it's how, because they're striking because they not about pay, it's more about the fact that
it is about pay.
Yeah, but the studio are taking people's rights. So it's, you know what, we like Black Mirror, Joan is Awful, is a really prevalent case of the fact that what is actually going on in Hollywood at the moment, where they're kind of like going, right, Joe Bloggs over here, you get paid 50 quid for today's job. What we're going to do is we're going to, in your contract, we're going to take your face and we're going to stick it in the background of like any movie that we want. So you only get paid once. You don't get paid every single time that you're on camera. And that's kind of what it is with the writers as well. The writers are kind of making these TV shows or Netflix, which are massive. You look nowadays, like Strange Things, but because it's not I don't know if it's because of the syndication or the way that like HBO and all that sort of stuff on a TV, they're not getting the back end of it. It's sort of seen Netflix, and it's just they're not getting the money. And so the writers becoming, they have to take more and more jobs, I guess, to kind of keep their head against water.
To,
I don't know.
to put this in some kind of context. So you know, David Dasmotion.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't know him personally, but
mentioned on Instagram today, in fact, that he starred in a major massive movie that was put out on streaming. I'm guessing it's going to be like probably something like Suicide Squad 2, maybe. And basically he said he received a residuals check for $22.50 or something. And this movie's been like streamed over like 500 million times, and it's like one of the biggest box office streaming movies. And like, that's how much he gets in residuals. It's just like, what the fuck? Just puts it into context how much that they get paid for nothing. I mean, it's like another person I heard. So I don't know if obviously Butch, you have to, but the TV show The Bear, the writer on that gets an amount of money. He doesn't get to work for anybody else because he's contracted for The Bear, which is only like 3 months of work. And then for the rest of the year, he can't work. So he gets a set amount of money. And this is one of the biggest shows on streaming right now.
So yeah, that's not the only other argument, though. The other argument is always implementing AI into a lot of things now. So. Yeah. They're really worried about just AI taking over, like writing the scripts to the computers, just writing the scripts and like the right is being shunned. So for like they don't take a stand now and clamp down before, you know, AI gets out of control, there won't be any people writing films or TV shows or anything anymore. It'd just be like probably they're responsible for the concept and the characters, and then the AI would just take over and just generate scripts out of nothing.
That's because it's I mean they're not even saying that. They're saying, look, even if you do take an AI script, it's not where it needed to be, that it was perfect. So still writers have to come in and change things. But the thing is, they're not getting credited or paid right to even do that.
Yeah.
So they'll come in and get paid absolutely nothing to do that. And then they'll carry on.
I think what we'll see is the quality of TV and movies at the top end going down. And I think we have done. And I think like what you're going to do is you're seeing a generation of like indie stuff coming up. That's what I think you're going to start to see over the next couple of years, like a lot of more indie breaking through with it all. If they don't change it, because I think we're Marvel obsessed, DC, you know, probably like superhero. But at the moment, I'm fucking bored. It's just fucking boring. It's like everything you go and watch. Yeah, but it's fucking like, stop being 3 hours, 2.5 to 3 hours long, when you can tell a story in fucking an hour and a half and it being awesome. Like, it's just everything's being like, it's just too big.
Yeah.
I don't know.
My complaint with the Batman earlier, it was cool when it was just this small story, but then it just went on and they expanded it into this bigger thing, and it didn't need to be 3 hours long, you know?
That brings it nicely onto the cinemas and the fact that, you know, cinemas are struggling at the moment. They don't make money on their tickets. They make their money on their food, which is astronomical. And their markup is amazing. And I love the cinema and I want it to last and I want everybody to go. I think the whole Barbie Oppenheimer thing is amazing. Barbenheimer, whatever you want to call it. You know, me and Butch going to the cinema the other day, we couldn't even find a parking space, and that hasn't happened for about 8 years. Back into the 80s.
Yeah, that happened to me on Friday when I went to see Talk To Me. I just couldn't get parked anywhere.
It's crazy. And like, I watched Talk To Me Tuesday, and so I was in there by myself, but in the small screen, but the small screen was full. That was great. So for a horror, and then, but then I was out and in. And they were like, obviously, ongoing Barbie fucking streams.
All wearing pink.
So much. There's so many people watching that movie. It's just on and on. It's not making. Considering I didn't see that, like, during, say, let's go to take an example, like, I don't know, the first Guardians, maybe, or like some of the Avengers. It didn't feel that busy when I went to see those movies, and maybe because they were on more screens. I don't know. But like, it feels busier now when I'm going to watch movies.
I think because preferably, well, most importantly, the last couple of weeks is that you've had Mission Impossible, Barbie, Oppenheimer, Talk To Me, Turtles. They're bringing them all out one by one. And I think one thing I will say on that, I think bringing Talk To Me out at that time was fucking brave, because it's, you know how long it's been? It's not even been in the cinemas a week. If you go and look at times now, they're all phased out. It's such a shame. But I get it, you know, I get it.
Can I chuck my 10 pence in?
Go for it.
Well, so I have one word, and it's not used in any sort of context other than, right, it's called balls, right? And I'm talking to every fucking studio executive out there. Have the balls to have conviction in projects, right? So trying to rely on, like, you think, I've got to get a Marvel film or a DC film out that's going to make me guaranteed money, because I'm starting to feel that model isn't working anymore, because, like Paul said, the quality is shit, right? Start concentrating on the reason people go to see films. Like, Talk To Me will earn a ton of money off word of mouth. People won't know what it is because they haven't been to the cinema to see any trailers, but someone will go and see this film. It's really scary, yeah? Barbie and Oppenheimer. I mean, Oppenheimer's benefited from Barbie. I mean, it's Christopher Nolan, so everyone knows it is. But Oppenheimer has piggybacked Barbie, right? But it's an idea. But guess what? The Barbie film, even though I haven't seen it, is supposed to be really good. There's no point bringing a Barbie film out and being shit, because people just go and get deflated. Back your writers, back your staff, back the projects and get people into cinemas, because if there's buzz about stuff and there's word of mouth saying this is really good and you need to see it now, people will go to the cinema, right? If you produce a film that's shite, like any DC film for the past 10 years, excluding the Dark Knight trilogy, right? People aren't going to go and see it because they don't have to, because they know it's shit. And they'll just wait for it to either come out on physical or come out on streaming, because it's not a necessity to go and see it. Have the balls to fucking say no to something that is guaranteed money, and I use fucking guaranteed in loose terms, and go after stuff that is actually going to challenge people and actually, you know, and it's always going to be hit and miss. But a great film will, whether it does shit at the box office or whatever, and has its life on physical media, you know, greatest film, one of the greatest films voted of all time ever, Shawshank Redemption, right? No one went to see it at the cinema, but it's made a shitload of money for New Line Cinema from video sales. Why? Because someone watched it and went, you know what, this is really good, I'm going to tell my mate, and that's how it works.
But that won't be the same moving forward. That won't be the same moving forward, though. You ain't got the same levels of people buying physical media.
But I
predict, I am going to do my Nostradamus in a minute. Now, obviously, I work for a well-established company. But the thing that you're probably going to find now with this strike, which I fully in support of and fully agree with, I think what's going to happen, in order to get things back on track, the streaming giants, who are your Netflix, your Amazons, whatever, they need to start paying more money out. So in residual checks or however it works. What then will happen is their catalogue will drop, because they can't afford to keep every fucking film and start paying everybody loads of money. So their catalogue's going to get wiped out. You've already started seeing it. Disney are wiping out their own catalogue.
But my problem is like, going back to the cinema thing, is that when you're bringing out films like Guardians Volume 3, and you're bunging it on literally Disney Plus like 2 months later, that to me is damaging it as well. Why? There's a massive amount of people that are not like us that love going to the cinema. There's a massive percentage that go, why would I bother when it's going to be literally, I could sit in my like living room and watch it. How do you think that they can get more people through the doors? I personally think that they should show more older movies as well. And they need to do more event stuff,
which Cineworld has started to do on the odd. Like, you get, like, for instance, I told you they got Enter the Dragon, like 50th
anniversary. Yeah, I know they do that.
Coming
yeah.
up, and they're definitely doing more of it. You're seeing it, you know, like the 40, 50, 4K restorations and all this sort of stuff that are like coming off. It's almost like once every 6 months.
But why not do more? Why not do?
Or maybe this is the start of a shift in terms of cinema. You know what I mean? What Jordy Paul was saying is right. It's like the everyday man's not that bothered. He'll go to the cinema if he's really excited about something. But as you say, unless it's something like Oppenheimer, then he's probably not going to worry too much. You know what I mean? It's us movie buffs that are keeping the cinemas going. So maybe they should cater towards us and, as you say, do old films, do releases. You know what I mean? Like
100%.
Okay, so it's all more of a niche instead of trying to fill these multiplexes with these Marvel movies and stuff, which is like they've got too long in the tooth now. They need to focus. I don't know what the answer is, but they need to. It's a shift happening somewhere. Then
I think they're victims. I think they're always going to be victims of the wider picture, though, because I went to see Alien and Aliens in a double Sean, which is like film buff heaven. You know what I mean? And there were six people in the cinema.
That is true, yeah.
So I don't necessarily, like, I would love to see every retro film gone, you know what I mean? There's a ton of films I would love to see, but I don't know if that's going to necessarily
go. Yeah, it's true. I've gone to see what? Classics and I've been the only person in there.
Quality of film and the effort from the studios, right, which is, they're never going to get. Barbie, right? I'm telling you now, right, if you look at the figures of how much money they spent on marketing for Barbie, right, they'll have spent a lot, but I don't think they'll spend as much as you think they're going to spend on other films, because it was just they rode the wave. They rode the wave. And Chris Nolan must be laughing himself silly, because the amount of people that went to see Oppenheimer, like, I was in the cinema. When I went to see Oppenheimer, there was people who came out of Barbie and went straight into Oppenheimer. And to be fair, I pissed myself when Oppenheimer finished, because I thought, they're going to fucking hate that. But they did it just for the crack. And it's how you tap into that. How do you go, I I need to go and see this. But like you said, Mike, you're right in saying go back to, you need to wait 4 months before it comes out on physical media or a streaming site.
Yeah.
And if so you really afford to wait that long,
it's got to be like, to go and see that? It's like the brutal days of the past where you'd have to wait like 6 months for it then to become rentable or even like a year to buy it, to have at home.
Remember hearing about films that came out
Dangle the Carrot, man,
before you were going to see it?
It's too instant. It's too instant.
Yeah. And do you remember like back in the day, like that's another thing now it doesn't help is just the quick turnaround. Films are in and out the cinema so quickly now that you don't really get a chance. I mean, when Jurassic Park came out, that fucking thing was playing for 6 months.
Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, when I was like, 10, 11? I went and saw that film fucking five times. First movie I went to see. That was out for fucking, and like Wet, the song was in the charts.
Bro. Brian Adams, not Wet.
Whatever. But you know,
He-Man, Masters of the Universe. That was on for about 20 years.
I think we've got to close this conversation because we've got to talk about the next movie. But yeah, like,
I saw you getting bored, didn't you, mate?
Yeah, well, a little bit. But like, you know,
I find it fascinating. I'd
love to see the data on how many blockbusters were released each year from like the 1980s compared to now, because it feels like now there's like fucking almost 20 to 30 blockbusters a year.
Do you know the interesting thing on this? This is where shit starts to get real and the shit really hits the fan, is that if Netflix, Amazon, Disney Plus, all these streaming sites, if they do go down the ad route, they have to then tell everybody all their figures and facts and how much they're making, how much they're paying, because it's all on record and they've got to expose that. And that's when it's going to get really interesting.
I think there'll definitely be a shift into more of a, and you might think this is wishful thinking for me, but I think there'll definitely be a shift towards physical again, because if you can't get it, you'll have to buy it from somewhere else.
Fingers crossed, mate. Fingers crossed.
Well, hopefully, but I genuinely do think that's going to happen. Anyway.
Should we talk about some inbreds?
Right then.
Hi, John. Hey. Oh, I did it.
Right. Let's move on to our move from the vault.
Where are you going, city boy?
We'll find it.
It ain't nothing but the biggest river in the state.
These are the men. Nothing very unusual about them. Suburban guys like you or your neighbor. Nothing very unusual about them until they decided to spend one weekend canoeing down the Cahoolawasee River. Ed Gentry. He runs an art service. Wife Martha has a boy, Dee. Lewis Medlock has real estate interests, talks about resettling in New Zealand or Uruguay. Drew Ballinger, he's sales supervisor for a soft drink company. Bobby Tripp, bachelor, insurance and mutual funds.
Where you going?
All right, I'm looking.
These are the men who decided not to play golf that weekend. Instead, they sought the river.
Out there anywhere watching us right now. We ain't gonna be so nice not hard to follow dragging a corpse.
Lewis, I'm gonna pull off to the side. There's something wrong.
No, go on!
Thank you.
John Boorman's film of James Dickey's explosive best-selling novel.
Okay, so this week's movie from the vault was my pick, and it was 1972's Deliverance. So a quick plot synopsis. Intent on seeing the Kalawassee River before it's dammed and turned into a lake, outdoor fanatic Lewis Medlock takes his friends on a canoeing trip they'll never forget into the dangerous American backcountry. So, boys. Well, we'll start with Butch, because Butch has never seen this before. So,
yeah, this is a proper movie. I didn't like it's a movie. That's the thing. I don't know. Like, I get the horror elements in it and stuff like that. And I can see why we'd want to pick and try and pick this through. But this is like, and I've avoided this for years. And I don't know fucking why. But like, I've watched The Deer Hunter, lots of like those sort of movies around that era, the sort of post Vietnam. Movies and stuff like that, and it's like, I don't know, for this, for some reason I just thought, oh, I don't know, I just didn't want to watch a guy get, you know, raped in the woods, maybe, I don't know. But it's a genuinely a really good movie, like well acted, well structured, and like well photographed. It's very DIY in its approach. It's sort of like kind of up my street in the way that it's filmed. Nice little, you know, going on a little canoe trip down the river.
You should love this shit. You love all that crap.
I got a bow and arrow.
I was thinking when I was watching it, I was thinking this could easily happen to Butch. Easily.
Which end?
Right. I mean, it's been.
No, I just think it'd be a bit quick, but a little bit of why I actually picked this film is this is in like my top five scariest films of all time. One of my real fears is sort of that hillbilly sort of Hills of Eyes type of stuff. So it's always freaked me out, and I think I've only ever seen it twice. Well, twice before, and it just freaks me out. It still does. So yeah. So well, that's George the background of why I picked it. So John,
well, George Paul, you haven't grown up in Swindon, mate.
I know I've been out in Swindon though, so that freaked me out. Only once, never again.
Go on, so, John.
John, what did you think?
Yeah, it's a good movie. It's really got that hallmark of feeling like it's a classic film. You know, it's, as you say, it's very reminiscent of like what you said, like The Deer Hunter or like Taxi Driver. It's kind of like of that ilk. You know, it's got that real. I don't know, just something about the filmmaking. It just feels like a proper film. You know.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's a good movie. I saw it initially, I think I was 18, because I remember I was in student halls when I was at uni, and the guy next to me was doing a course on American studies, some bullshit course, I don't know. And he's like, they've given me a stack of movies to watch, and one of them was Deliverance. He was like, do you want to watch it? And I didn't have any idea what it was about. And I remember watching it at the time and just, you know, that infamous scene really stuck with me. I was like, bloody hell. Strange choice for American studies, but there you go. Maybe it was a part of the course where one of the basic
wow. I don't know.
But I remember that some of the visual imagery always stuck with me, and I don't think I'd seen it until now, this week. And again, watching it in HD and everything, I was absolutely really floored by the movie making. I thought it was really exceptional. It's got some strange choices in it, I think. Some decisions that they made was a bit odd. But, yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I was surprised at how tense it was. I was really, like, on the edge of my seat in parts of this. And it, being an older movie, it still had a lot of punch to it. I was surprised at how much weight it had. But, yeah, I really enjoyed it. It's a good pick.
Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed this because it's been a long time since I've seen it. And just like I think I saw it when I was a lot younger as well, and it was interesting because I completely totally missed kind of the social element of it as well, with the fact that they're basically building this huge fucking dam that's going to take away all these houses that they don't really give a fuck about, and it's sort of got that kind of element running through it, and with the kind of, you know, kind of the comments and the inbred and the kind of like, you know, are you as bad as them? Are they as bad as you? Kind of thing going through
yeah.
it.
But yeah, it asked a lot of questions, didn't it?
Yeah. Like, what's right and what's wrong? You know what I mean? It's just like, it has you questioning kind of a lot of different things, which
and
I found
even back then I was surprised because they're talking about where society is going, and he's all like, "Oh, we're all going to be replaced with machines and stuff." And
yeah,
I was like, "Jesus." Talking
to machines, fucking Burt Reynolds in this movie. I had feelings when he showed up.
He's got a pretty mouth. I mean, he was built. He was. I mean, he's a very attractive.
I want to get myself one of those cut off fucking wetsuit vests, man. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he looked pretty dapper in that outfit.
anyone who watches The Walking Dead, Daryl Dixon ain't got shit on Burt Reynolds.
Right, I got to read something quickly. Anthrocarbophobia is a fear of rednecks or hillbillies. So there you go.
That's what I have. Yes, 100%.
Wow.
But yeah, this is a proper movie that we got to watch. You know, that's what the way I felt about it. And it's like the harrowing scenes and stuff, the sort of nervousness and tension building with the simple going down the rapids, which, you know, is really intense in sort of those moments that they sell. The dueling banjo scene.
Yeah, we got to talk about that first.
Oh my word, it was easy. Like, do you remember, like, we talked about it, it's like Cabin Fever, the kid with the cry and stuff like that. It's like that's where that was born from, really.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
100%, yeah.
It's nuts. It's like, it's just he's a really odd looking chap.
Wrong turn.
Well, yeah, exactly. Wrong turn, Hills of Eyes, all that sort of thing. But he can play a fucking mean banjo.
Weird. It's not the weird,
fingers
it?
He's got.
It's so weird. It's like that little that kid just the way he just is. I mean, he's not. He wasn't really a huge actor, but like literally, it's just like he's so weird and stone faced.
And it's so funny. I read an article about this actor like a week ago.
Okay.
Coincidence, and he's worked in and out of Hollywood as the years have gone on, but now he's literally just like working in like a supermarket or something, like stacking shelves.
Why the fuck isn't he doing like the circuit, like the sign circuit? Like, he'd clean up.
I think I might have read the same thing, but it wasn't like his official retirement from acting or something.
Oh, was it? Oh, I don't know.
Wasn't something like that? Yeah, I think it was. It was like he is now retired from acting. Oh, I was exactly. Like, what? Right.
But
yeah, why is he not doing every Comic-Con?
That scene is so interesting because it starts it off and it's just like everything just feels really unnerving from that get-go. It's like, and for the fact that what I find fucking hilarious is they're just happy to give their fucking cars to complete people that they've just fucking slagged off. And like, there you go, there's $40, now fucking drive my car, and then have the audacity to fucking drive in front of them all the way.
Isn't that one of the themes from the film though, mate? It's that whole like we are a higher class of citizen than you type of thing. Like,
sure,
you will do what I say. If I give you enough money, you'll do what I say. I've got enough money, I'm more educated than you. Even the duel and banjo scene, obviously you've got Ronnie Cox playing the banjo at him, and he's like, oh well, I'm going to test you. And actually realizes he's great. Now, obviously, Ronnie Cox is sort of like the emotional heartbeat of the film, but it's almost that like, I'm going to try and one up you. You can't be as good as me. And actually, he was quite pleased that the kid was great. But the rest of them were like, yeah, whatever. Yeah, it was almost like, yeah, whatever. It doesn't matter. Like, what are you on about? They were actually arseholes. They were arseholes to everybody at the start.
Yeah, they're all going very much with a chip on their shoulder and very cocksure of themselves. Like, even when he's driving to the lake, he's like telling them to slow down and why don't you go behind the other car? And he's like, I know my way around there. And he goes the wrong way and stuff.
That sounds like someone I know.
But 40 minutes into this movie, 40 minutes, we get the moment.
The synonymous moment.
Which I didn't think he fought hard enough, to be honest. If someone was going to try and rape me, I'd fight a lot harder than that.
I did think that.
Those heels looked a bit slippery, you know?
Or do you think he just was like, he seriously didn't think it was going to come to that? He just thought the guy was fucking with him. Like, not literally.
I'm sure it's a case of like, you know, there's a fucking shotgun there, and I'm like, I'm in like shock and awe, and like, what the fuck? What are they making me I'm not taking my pants off. You got a shotgun in front of me. We shoot me in the fucking head. I ain't living with the fact.
Shoot him in the dick.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'll shoot him in the dick if it moves.
Yeah, maybe. Like, did you, as a viewer? Well, we knew it was coming, but I was watching this with Ziv, and she had no idea that was
going
to a rape. Yeah, she's like, oh my god, it's, what? So he's raping him. I was like, yeah. So she thought he was just like fucking around, you know, like slapping him and like just trying to humiliate him. She didn't realize it was going to go to that level. So maybe that's what character thought, you know.
Because he was getting really turned on by the piggy noises. that's what I'm like thinking. Well, he must have fucked a pig.
Right.
Like, literally must have. Because that's what gets him going, obviously.
That is quite interesting, though. Like, because obviously I have never seen the film, but I knew that was coming. I could hear all the, you know, those lines and stuff like that, which you've heard time and time again in like different fucking guises and stuff like that. You got a pretty mouth. You know, it's like, fuck, I've heard that fucking thousands and thousands of times in different sort of pop culture and all this sort of weird stuff emulated. And I imagine watching that in 1972 and just like the first time you're like, oh, what a bunch of cunts. Why is he slapping him? Why is he riding him like a pig? Why the fuck has he got his cock in his ass? Oh, God.
What is he doing to those massive, oversized Y fronts?
Oh,
to see that in that, get into that, that view would have been something.
I mean, it was shocking when I saw it in 98 when I was like 18. God knows what the fuck people thought in 72.
I mean, and not only that, old John Voight gets literally tied to the fucking tree to watch.
Yeah.
and that's the thing, the dread is, you know, he's next. Because you're like, they're done with
him as well, though. Doesn't it feel like he's not trying very hard to get out of that strap just around his neck?
He's got like the pipe stuck in there. That's not going to do much, is it? It's just making him breathe a little bit.
I did think that. I just thought, I'm not going to let my mate get fucked up the ass. I'm just not going to do it. Sorry, Matt, I wouldn't let it happen to you. That was it.
Cheers, mate. And I would have fought a little bit harder, I hope.
Yeah. Then the whole moral...
You might like the feeling of the collar on the tree against your neck, Matt. You never know.
The moral quandary afterwards, though. I don't know. That, for me, that's not really that... Yeah, that was an interesting sort of scenario in terms of debate about, are we going to bury this guy, or what are we going to do? Are we going to go to the police? All this sort of stuff. It's like, you can't really go... There's no witnesses and all this sort of shit.
Yeah, I really enjoyed that part. I was like literally scratching my head thinking, what would you do in this situation? Like, what a fucking dilemma to be in. And it's just like back and forth. I think all of us would agree, you just fucking ditch the body somewhere, right? And just run.
All right, Burt Reynolds, calm down. Calm down, Burt
Reynolds. I don't know why I was fucking about trying to bury it. I would have just, as they did with the other guy, put some rocks.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
In the river, done. And then get
This place is going to be underwater in a couple of months, so fuck it.
I would be like, hello, I was the one who was raped. I'll make the decisions.
Right, so we've already established, right now, lads, we've just established that, right, John is Burt Reynolds, Matt is John Voight, I'm Ronnie Cox, and Paul's Ned Beatty.
He
does do a good impression.
That's another thing as well, right? After he's been raped, they're supposed to be good friends in that, but they don't seem to be, like, that consoling to their friend that's just been...
They kind of brush over it.
Like, no one comes over and says, you're right, mate, how you doing? They're all just worried about what they're going to do with the body.
Yeah, how's your ass? Do you need some Vaseline?
Well, he does say, though, doesn't he? He's like, I don't want anyone to know. He's like, I don't want it talked about. So sort of like, all right, then, well.
But I still would have buried that body a lot deeper, like fucking handle sticking out and shit. It's like, what the fuck, boys? Come on, dig deeper.
I mean, he did sort of allude, he did say later, obviously, it's like, I'm not going to see you guys for a while. I'm going to go and hide.
I'm not going to see you again.
But I did think Burt Reynolds' character at that point took it a complete different tone. Like, it almost felt like he was like a man without anything to lose. I don't know if I was watching it thinking, has he got some past to run away from? And this is like, the reason he wants to do this type of shit is because he's like, I don't know, there's something going to happen to him soon. Well,
they really latched on that thing of that he doesn't give a shit about life, the way he drove, the way he doesn't really have any kids. He's just fucking like full on 100.
Yeah, so actually, in some kind of way, he's sort of glad this happened.
But again,
and it never says that, but it, you feel like he's like, well, whatever, what about it?
It's that deer hunter of all. They didn't allude to it as much in this movie, but I have to imagine that because it's like the whole post-Vietnam War, they have to kind of had that some, that they have to have been some kind of interaction with that era. So, you know, that has to be a reason. But they didn't really go into it in this movie, I don't think. I don't think they even said whether they've come back from Vietnam or not. But it felt like to me that if they're sort of living in that era, then they kind of had to be that whole PTSD thing.
That's
the
great thing about that, that type of film, Paul. It leaves you with these questions that you have to think about and you have to just stay on it. And I love that type of stuff.
Well, another question is that he wasn't shot, right? Their mate wasn't shot on the boat.
It was so confusing, right? Well, I'm the only one thinking that. It's like he just took a nosedive into the.
I rewound it and like I'm like he didn't get shot and like he just
wasn't
couldn't cope and so he just fucking dove off the edge. I think.
Yeah,
that's it. He wasn't shot. He just couldn't cope with the whole moral ambiguity of it all. He was like, which makes the next bit even worse.
Doesn't that? Don't you think that was too quick, though? Like, you see him paddling, and he's like, where are your life preserver? And he's, like, ignoring him. And the next minute, he just takes a nosedive into the water. There wasn't much build-up to that.
I felt a bit disjointed at that point.
Yeah, kind of left. I know what it was going for. As you say, his conscience was eating at him, but it was too...
True. But the kind of guy that he is like, you think, oh, he's quite a strong-willed person, because he is very kind of looks at both sides of the kind of thing. It's like, you know, we should report ourselves, as like, and he's got like a wife and kids at home. It's just like, that's what made me think, well, he's like, that's a bit of a weird one. I think he should have been like just maybe knocked in or something by accident.
I was kind of hoping when they discovered his body that he had been shot, because I was like, that would make more sense, you know?
Yeah.
Or I suppose what would have been good if Burt Reynolds had sort of pushed him in or done him over type of thing, because he knew he wouldn't be able to handle, like, he would have folded under questioning. Or
what a departure, though, that Ronnie Cox from what he plays in RoboCop.
Yeah, he just went into then like serial villain, which is such a juxtaposition. It's unbelievable.
I was watching it, I'd get my head around it. I was like, I can't believe that's the same guy.
Fuck, I didn't even fucking put those two and two together. fuck. Yeah, that's quite different.
Do you know, you're familiar with who he's in RoboCop?
He's the fucking guy with the glasses, right?
No, not the guy with glasses. The one who's in the ball.
Cole Hagen? Oh, no, I'm talking about Total Recall now. By going Total Recall.
Who's he in RoboCop?
He's the one that's like, he's like...
The leader?
No, he's like
the OCP chairman.
Yeah,
he's the one that gets shot by Ed 209 through the window.
In a suit.
Ah, yeah. Okay. Fuck, I haven't put that together.
Yeah.
The chief in a Beverly Hills Cop.
Oh, yeah.
Blimey. but I mean, after this, there's not much else going on apart from like the investigation going back to sort of society and stuff like that. And obviously the movie just goes, obviously, what's his face?
Wait, hold up a minute. Can we not talk about what happens after that? Like, he takes a nosedive. So then they go down.
Can we talk about what happens with John Voight? Yeah.
Yeah. They go down the rapids and stuff, and the canoes all get fucked up, and they all like, that's pretty gnarly when Burt Reynolds' leg is all fucked. He's got a broken leg, and you see the fleshy bit sticking out in the bottom.
Yeah, that's weird.
And then John Voight then decides to become Rambo, doesn't he? And goes climbing up the mountain. Leaves the fat one down at the bottom there, and
Wow, he's got a sore ass. God, you wouldn't go rock climbing with a sore ass, would you?
But I have to comment on the very much hokey day for night shots that they included. I almost thought he had a psychedelic trip when he was climbing up the mountain there. But did you notice that? How weird the skies.
Yeah.
And that was
it did feel a bit like padding.
It felt like about.
I can understand why they did it, because it's very difficult to do night shoots, especially in a real location like that. But it did make me laugh. So the film was pretty much flawless in its cinematography, and then you got this hokey day for night. But then when he encounters the other redneck on top of the thing, how the hell did he manage to impale himself with his own arrow? Like.
I mean, that's some unlucky shooting, because I thought
Because I didn't even think he shot the guy. I was like, oh shit, he shot himself somehow. Yeah. And then the guy comes out and he's got an arrow for him. So like,
yeah, he shot the guy but fell backwards as he did it and then impaled himself on his like quiver essentially.
Right.
That's pretty genius, I thought, the way he did that.
Because I'm pretty sure then the doctor asked him how he did that later on in the movie and he don't say nothing.
Pretty embarrassing, yeah. I fell on an arrow.
I did like that bit, though. I love the bit where he obviously does it and he's like, right, pulls himself together. Because the guy's not a killer. Like, it's not like... That's the thing with Burt Reynolds is Burt Reynolds like the alpha male, like, fuck it, I'll just do what I need to do to survive. He's like the straight guy who's been tugged down this path that isn't like... He doesn't want to do it, but he's the only one who can do it. And then when he kills the guy, and he... I don't know if they switched actors, but it definitely doesn't look like the same actor.
No.
And you're sort of looking at it going, shit, has he killed the wrong person?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he feels like he's killed the wrong person, because obviously he checks his teeth.
He did kill the wrong person.
He did kill the wrong person.
Oh, I wasn't sure. I was like, is it the guy?
That was a different guy. That was the sheriff's brother, wasn't it?
No, but he checks his teeth, and he's wearing false teeth.
Yeah, he took his teeth out. Yeah, he did kill the right guy. The guy who raped the guy was the sheriff's brother.
Mm. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And he was the guy that they murdered and buried.
So they definitely killed the right person then.
Mm.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he did.
Okay.
Because I was a bit thrown by that. The reason I was thrown by that is because they take a shot of the not the sheriff's brother, but the other guy with no teeth. They take a shot of his hand and he's got a wedding ring. And that's why I thought that was, I got that. I got the feeling that was the sheriff's.
No.
Oh, well, I got it wrong then.
Fair enough.
It does lead you to believe, because he's like, no. He starts saying no because he doesn't recognize the guy.
Because
he pulls his false teeth out and he's like, all right, fair enough, it is.
I thought that was the moral quandary, that it was like they actually killed a hunter guy because that's why he was out hunting. And I didn't realize that. Oh, okay.
Maybe that's the point. Maybe the character's supposed to be as ambiguous as what we are to whether it's a
Very cool.
But yeah, it's cool. It's clever in that way. As I say, it asks a lot of questions. There's a lot of things that, you know, leaves your mind to ponder.
Mr. Luther.
And it's surprising to me because I didn't, after the, like, what, I always remember the film just finishes, they kill the guy and then it ends. And then ends again, go to that other house. And have the police get involved. I didn't remember that part at all, and I found that all to be really tense. I was like,
you don't know if they're going to get away with it.
Yeah.
Oh, and they do. They do. But old John Voight's having some bad dreams.
So. Should we get on to some Matt's facts?
I've got some good ones here. So while filming in the white water canoeing scene, Ned Beatty was thrown overboard and was sucked under by a whirlpool.
Sorry, but he's going to say
a production assistant dove in to save him, but didn't surface for 30 seconds. Sir John Borman asked Beatty, "How did you feel?" And Beatty responded, "I thought I was going to drown. And the first thought was, how will John finish the film without me? And my second thought was, I bet the bastard will find a way." Apparently, Burt Reynolds broke his coccyx tailbone while going down the rapids when the canoe capsized originally. A cloth dummy was used originally down the stream, but it looked too fake. So then they decided to send him down and he broke his coccyx, which is fucking crazy. According to director Sir John Borman, the gas station attendant's jig, the dueling banjos, was unscripted and spontaneous. That fucking was freaky, that dancing. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
That added to it big time. It's so weird. This is the movie Burt Reynolds appeared in as opposed to The Godfather in 1972. He was being considered for the part of Michael Corleone. But Brandon said that if Burt Reynolds was in his movie, he would quit. Yeah. Following the film,
Marlon Brando.
But Butcher loved this next one. Following the film, tourism increased to Rayburn County by the tens of thousands. By 2012, tourism was the largest source of revenue in the country. John Voight's stunt double for his film, Claude Terry, later purchased equipment used in the movie from Warner Brothers, and then he founded what was now the oldest whitewater rafting adventure company in the Chattatooga River Southern East Expeditions. By 2012, rafting had developed as a $20 million industry in the region.
Wow.
That's fucking crazy.
Now, now.
I will admit, though, when they first started off on their little canoe trip, when they were just paddling along in the beginning, I was quite enjoying it. I was like, oh, this is really nice. Pretty close.
It does look nice. However, I want to know how many tens of thousands of those people were looking for a good old bumming. During the film,
how many of them had pretty faces?
During the filming of the canoe scene, author James Dickey showed up inebriated and got into a bitter argument with Sir John Borman, who had rewritten Dickey's script. They had a brief fistfight in Borman's, and Borman's nose was broken and four of his teeth were shattered. Dickey was thrown off the set, but no charges were filed against him, and the two reconciled and became good friends, and Borman gave Dickey a cameo as a role as a sheriff at the end of the film.
Okay.
And this is fucking crazy. My last one. To minimize costs, the production wasn't insured and the actors did their own stunts.
Oh, wow.
So all that talk about insurance was a dig at, like, we don't need insurance. Fuck it.
See, this is when real men made real movies. This is why a cinema is in the state it's in.
Well, that's it.
Agree.
Yeah.
2 million. I looked at it, it's about 2 million budget estimated, and then like it made about like less than $5,000.
So it's really bad.
I don't know if they.
It's weird though, because it's such an iconic film. You thought it would have smashed it upon its release.
Mm. Especially with the tourism.
Got Oscars, didn't it?
Yeah. I don't know, mate, but I don't know. It was before the summer blockbuster that was Jaws. Mm. So who knows? Cool. That was really cool. Rating this bad boy then. Mine's a 9.
Well, I picked it, and it is one of my all time favourite. And you can argue if it's a horror film or not, but for me it scares the shit out of me. So I'm gonna give it a 10 out of 10, guys. I love it.
Yeah, I think I'd have to go with the 9. Rating as well. I think it's just a couple of bits in it that just hold it back for me from being a 10. As I say, just some weird stuff that didn't quite make sense to me. You know, like the guy taking a nosedive into the water and paling himself on his own arrow and stuff. And oh, and another bit when he just like decides to discard the weapons after he shoots the guy. He's like, oh yeah, my job's done here. Like, I don't need this crossbow. I don't need this shotgun. It just launches him into the water. It's like Jamie Lee Curtis in Halloween just throwing a knife away. It's like, what were you doing in the 70s, man? Jesus.
Burt Reynolds would have just charmed his way out of any situation in that film.
Yeah, it's a 9 from me. I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed it more second time round. I think I took more in. Interesting watch for me. Yeah.
It's definitely like, as I'm an older person now, like more mature watcher, I'd say I definitely got a lot more from it this time round.
Mm. Mm.
Cool. Right then, we've got a guest, John.
Butch,
Alleycat Jon.
You didn't actually give your score.
Mine's a 9.
Mine's in at the start. He said it was a 9.
I slipped it in. It wasn't.
Did you? Yeah. Oh, he slipped it in
like a hillbilly's crotch.
right. Moving on to, yeah, so we got to go our next pick, and I think that's John. Have you brought one with yourself for us to watch next time?
John in the darkness with a scary.
John, just before you go, the last two guests on the pod have made us watch avocados and people eating shit. So.
Yeah.
No pressure.
I suppose I should be kind to you this time.
Please let it be horror. Please let it be horror.
I was speaking Avocado Jungle Women Part 2, as I said to Matt earlier. Yeah, no, I'm going to pick one that is an 80s classic that doesn't really get talked about as much as it should. I don't know if we, I think Matt has definitely seen it because it's on his shelf. I can see it right behind him. It's on your VHS. It's at the top one. It's The Blob from 1988.
Oh. Yes! That is a great pick.
Yeah.
That's a good pick.
It's a very good film. And if you haven't seen it, what are you doing with your life?
Pour it right back into the horror. I like it.
I do not believe I have seen this.
Oh, you're in for a treat then.
I have seen The Blob, but I don't think it's the 80s one. So.
No, I think I've only seen the like 50s or 60s one.
Oh, really? So yeah, I'm not the only one that's seen it then. Oh, wow.
Which is the one with Steve McQueen in it?
Yeah, it's the 60s one.
That's the one I've seen. So.
Cool. That is a great pick. Nice one. Cheers for coming on, John. That was good fun, man.
Yeah, it's always good. Cheers, good laugh. We really enjoy coming on the pod.
And John, just quickly, where can people find you?
Where can they find me?
Yes.
In the woods, mostly.
On the Tallahassee River.
I was giving you the opportunity to plug your website.
I'm at alleycatgraphics.com. I do a lot of art, genre-related artwork. I have a thing coming out, probably the week the podcast drops. So I'm going to be doing a T-800 from the Terminator. I don't know if you can see it. Let's have a look. It might be because it's too dark.
Oh my God.
Right, there's three purchases already.
Yeah.
Because it's metal. It's all metal. You have to look
at it. Wow, mate. That's shiny.
Yeah. But
it looks like that's like you open a sticker packet.
John, just so you know, mate, the other day in Dublin, I got offered actually €35 for the Archer Danger Zone pin.
Oh, really?
Just because it was on the back of my backpack.
Oh, you could have sold it.
I told them to fuck off.
I'll send you another one.
It's priceless.
The money.
It's priceless. But just so you know. So yeah.
Oh, that's wicked. That's funny.
Yeah.
Awesome.
All right. Thanks everyone for listening to the podcast. If you'd like to take the time to go on to Apple Podcast, if you listen to it there, and do a little 5-star review, that'd be lovely. I know we're getting a few more listeners these days so if you wanted to show your love, show your appreciation, it always helps the podcast to get it out. Like to just thank John Joe Reviews as well as enough someone else to go and check it out. We saw the other day, definitely worth going out and checking his stuff on YouTube while we're here. And moving on to the next episode, we've got Meg 2 The Trench. Come on, we know how we feel about the Meg. Whew, can't wait. I'll have something to scream about. We will be bringing another beautiful conversation. And John's just pulled from the vault, I think it's 1988 or 1989's The Blob. Cannot bloody wait. And there's only one more thing to say. When there's no more room in hell, here's another podcast.
I am the devil, and I am here to do the devil's work.
You can follow us on Twitter at @DrawOneLast, Instagram at @DrawOneLastBreath, or pop us an email at @DrawOneLastBreathPod@hotmail.com.